Let's look at an example. I created a class called Circle. It has a single field, that's my radius, private. It has one parameterized constructor. I have some input validation. I make sure that my radius is not less or equal to zero. In that case, I throw an illegal argument exception because the radius needs to be positive. If the value passed was a valid radius, then I'm going to assign it to my field radius. Here I have a method, it's called area, and my area returns radius squared times pi. And I also have a toString method, and my toString method, I just represent my current instance. I say this is a circle with radius of a given value. I also wrote a circle app. Here in my circle app, I create an instance, I print it out, and I print the area. So I'm going to run it here. Circle has radius 10 and the area is 314.2. In my application, I also want to see whether this works with, let's say, minus 10. If I'm passing minus 10, I'm expecting an illegal argument exception. And yes, here it is, illegal argument exception, radius has to be greater than 0. That's good. I also want to make sure that works for 0, because 0 is a boundary value, also an illegal value for a radius. So here I have another illegal argument exception. Radius has to be greater than 0. This is the traditional way how people use to test. You write yourself a program, you try it out with different input, and if your program is small enough, it works just fine. As the program gets bigger, this is too time consuming, especially the retesting every time you change your program, and you want to make sure there was no regression. Now I'm going to demonstrate in this example how we can write a unit test. It's a good practice to separate the source code from the test code. So I'm starting by creating a separate test folder. Here I go to new, we're going to create another source folder here, and I'm going to call my source folder test. And now I'm going to my circle. Circle is the class that I want to unit test. I right click it and I'm going to add something new, and the new thing I want to add are jUnit test cases. I checked the ready button for jUnit 4. This is a version that uses annotations. That's the version I like to use. Let's have a look at the source folder. Right now it is set to source, but we want to have our tests in the folder test. So I'm going to change this right here. I call it test. I also want to point out the checkboxes down here. You can see there's a setup and a teardown. It does for me the following. Setup is a method that is run before each of my unit tests. The order in which unit tests are executed is not guaranteed. Let's assume I would have a list of products and I want to update, add, remove items. In order to be able to predict the outcome of my adding, removing, updating, I need to know what is in my list when I start. And I could use this setup method to reset my list to a fixed sequence of products every time before a test is executed. Teardown is the opposite. It's run right after each of my tests finished execution. Setup before class is run a single time before all the tests in my class execute. I could use this, for example, to open a database connection. And then the counterpart, teardown after class, is executed one single time after all the unit tests have been run. Here, for example, I could close my database connection. In our case, we don't need these options because we have a very small example. So I'm just going to press next here. It lists all the different methods that are available for my circle. Here are the methods from object. I'm not going to test those. The Java API is very well tested already, but I do want to test my own constructor and my own methods here. At this point, I press finish. Notice in my folder test, a new package has been created that matches the name of the package in my source folder, and I have a new file, circle test, so with a suffix test, and that includes my unit tests right here. Each of them has a @test annotation right before the method declaration. Also, each of them has a statement that's called fail. So we want to make sure we don't accidentally believe we have working unit tests when they haven't been implemented yet. So if I run my unit test, I would get a big red bar. It says all three tests failed. Yes, they did, because we called fail. The first test is testing my constructor, the second one, the area, the third one, the toString method. Let's check back on the circle. You can see both area and toString are instance methods, so we need an instance. I'm going to create that here as a field. So I have a private circle, C is a new circle, let's say of radius 10. And now I'm going to implement my area. I say my expected value is of type double, because my radius is of type double, and I'm going to assign the value r squared times b. My radius is 10, so this would be 100 times math.py. My double actual value is the area from a circle. Now I want to make sure that the area calculated is the value that I expected. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to call one of those assert methods. See that Eclipse gave us already a static import of the assert class, which makes life a little easier. I can just call my assertEquals, and there's a whole list of different options. Notice some of them are crossed out, that means they're deprecated. I need a version for double. I don't like the deprecated version. I keep looking, there's another one. It has three parameters. First, the expected value, then the actual value, and then a delta. We have this third parameter, this delta, when we use double values because of the internal representation of floating point numbers that can lead to small imprecisions. So the delta specifies how big can be the difference, so I will still consider both values equal. Here I'm going to choose this very method right here. My expected value is my expected value, my actual value is my actual value, and here is my delta. This is the only place where I compare double values, so I'm just going to decide what is good enough for me. Let's say 0.01. I'm going to run. Let me make this window a little bit bigger. And it shows me that this time I have two failures. So I had three runs and I had two failures. I can see it as one check. My area passed already. Now I'm going to implement my toString method. Here I'm starting with an expected value. This time my expected value is a string, because toString returns a string. Expected is circle with radius 10.0. My actual value is whatever the toString method returns. And once again we have assertEquals. And this time we want something that allows the comparison between two strings. And if I'm checking, I can see double, I can see long. Here I have two objects. That works nicely because string is an object. So I'm comparing my expected and actual value. I'm compiling here and running. And you can see at this point we have one failure and we have two checks, which is great. The one test that hasn't passed is the test where I'm testing my constructor. I'm especially interested in my exception. Here you can see my circle is supposed to throw an exception. My argument passed is either zero or negative. So this is what I'm going to test right here. I'm going to make two test cases. I'm passing circle with 0. And what I expect is an illegal argument exception. So here I'm going to use an extra parameter here. I say expected is illegal argument exception dot class. This is a class literal that I'm using here, and it indicates that this method should throw an illegal argument exception. Now I'm going to do that by creating a new circle with value 0. And then I expect the exact same behavior when I'm passing a negative number. So here I change my name. It's called test circle with negative number, with negative radius. And I'm going to pass, let's say, minus 10. Once again, I'm going to run. And this time my bar is green. 4 tests have been run, 4 tests succeeded. My illegal argument exceptions have been thrown at the appropriate times. My area matches the expected output, so does the toString method.